We're going to gather together. I guess you're already gathering in your own circles. Let's come together and we want to worship our Lord together this morning. It's a great opportunity for us to express our gratitude to our Lord for what he has done for us. So let us pray. Father God, we come before you. You are the God of peace. And Father, we ask that you would bring peace to our hearts here this morning. Father, sometimes life seems chaotic and just kind of maybe out of control. But Father, you bring peace. Father, we remember the scriptures about you saying peace be still to the chaotic seas and the rough waters. And Father, we know that you can just say right now to the things going on in our life, peace be still. And Father, we believe that right now. We want your presence into this place right now so that we can be still and know that you are God in this place. And we want to just glorify you from the depths of our heart. And Father, we come before you and just ask that, Lord, that you would be pleased with what we offer up to you today. We offer up to you a sacrifice of praise. And Father, come and be with us in this place. Move in our hearts. Move in this place, Father. We welcome your Holy Spirit. Guide us, Lord Jesus. Amen.
For our 10-year anniversary, my wife and I walked through our venue where we had celebrated our wedding. And one of our fond memories was that for vows, I wrote my vows in limericks. And when I wrote those to her, it was a love offering for my wife. And wouldn't it have been odd if I had like written her a poem and someone asked me afterwards, oh, so what did you get out of that? It's ridiculous, right? Because who's the poem for? It was an offering of love to her. So I'm saying that during the worship time right now, certainly be receptive to what the Holy Spirit might say, but this is a time to offer worship to the Lord. Amen? Amen. So instead of thinking, what am I going to get out of this, can we offer a love offering to the Lord during our worship today? Amen. All right. If you'd like to, you can stand and we can sing together, or if you're not able to, we know that you're standing in your heart.
Gold. beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up here a song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me and I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
Amen, amen. Can we read this scripture together? Let's go back. I know we all know it, but let's read it together. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Amen.
Come all you weary, come all you thirsty, come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Come all you sinners, come find his mercy. Come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for. For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever.
Amen. Do you believe that this morning? That's right. With our faith, he has made us whole and reconciled us. Even amidst our sin, God saves us if you bring your confession to him. So, Lord, we give you thanks and praise for your faithfulness to cleanse us from all unrighteousness, because you are good and faithful.
Bring all your failures, bring your addictions. Come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting there with open arms. See his open arms. For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever.
Lord, we give you praise.
Praise God, praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, for the wonders of his love.
Let's sing that again.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, for the wonders of his love, his amazing love. For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save. For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save. Forever. the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting. God so loved the world.
What a wonderful testimony we have in Jesus. Amen.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, worship your holy name. The sun comes up.
Father God, we pray for your woman, pastor of this church. Father, we thank you for her. We thank you for sending her to us. We thank you for her heart that she has for you, heart she has for this people, this church. Father, we know that she's kind of has a little burden right now. She's weighing heavy on her with this message that you have given to her. Father, Lord, just something special here today. Something special in this message that we need to hear. Father, we ask that your Holy Spirit would come, that you would anoint her with her tongue, anoint her heart and everything of this message, Father. We'd ask that you would just bless us by hearing your voice come through this message today, Father. We ask that you would move in this place. We ask that you bring peace, bring comfort, and just bring your presence, Lord Jesus. We love you, Jesus.
Amen. Thank you.
And now, children, we're going to go with Marlis. Okay?
All right. Thank you so much, Pastor Mike. Thank you. Thank you so much, Pastor Daniel. And Steve and Norm, thank you so much. Kiddos, hooray! Hooray for the kiddos. They're going to have a good time today with Miss Marlis. All right. Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to South Bay Church of the Nazarene. Welcome. So if you remember last week and in the prior weeks, we've been going through the book of Ephesians. Right? And we are almost done in the book of Ephesians. Yay! Finally, we can see the end of the tunnel. Yes. And today we begin the very last chapter, chapter 6. So as you guys are moving, oh, I have it right here, my cell phone. Because I left my Bible on my desk like a silly goose. Turn. Either in your Bibles or your cell phones or your tablets, to Ephesians chapter 6. And while you're doing that, I'm going to keep talking, okay? So last week, we did the very end of Ephesians chapter 5, husbands and wives, right? Wives, submit to your husbands. Husbands, love your wives. And I don't know if you remember, but at the very end of the message last week, I said, don't worry, next week is going to be easier. We're going to talk about children and slaves. And everybody laughed, right? And I thought that this week would be easier. Well, I lied. I did. I lied. I didn't know I was lying. I apologize. But yes, I lied. This was harder. This was definitely harder. But we are only going to be doing the first 9 verses in chapter 6 so that we can end on a high note next week with the very last bit of Ephesians chapter 6. And I think, I'm not going to say next week's going to be easier because, you know, the Holy Spirit's going to convict me about something and it's going to end up being much harder. So I'm not going to say that. I'm not going to say that for next week. And for those of us who have read this book previously, this letter to the Ephesians, we know that the end of chapter 5 and the beginning of chapter 6 can be one of the most controversial passages in the entire Bible, right? For those of you who don't know this, it is one of the most controversial chapters in the entire Bible. And if you think about the Bible, I mean, it's a big old honking book. I wish I'd brought mine. It's a big old book. You guys see me coming up here. You guys have your Bibles with you. It's a big old honking book. And so for this to be one of the most controversial passages, that means something, right? Because it's a pretty stinking big book. Well, I am going to try to make this as easy as possible. All right? Now, I'm falling back on that phrase that I use all the time. Context is everything. I feel like maybe Pastor Daniel, maybe we need to like create a little jingle about context is everything, because I say it every time I'm up here. And it's not just me who says this every time I'm up here. Pastor Mike says context is everything. Pastor Daniel says context is everything. We all say context is everything. If you're teaching in one of the Sunday school classes or Wednesday night, we're always referring back to context. Context, 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 context. So that we can understand it, the Bible, in better, right? So this week, we have a couple of contexts, all right? Primarily a historic one, historic context. But we also need to acknowledge a context of bias. Now, I don't know if you remember last week, but I talked briefly about biases, and how we all have them, right? We all have them, whether they're unconscious or not. In some aspects, one of the few who have, you're so sweet, babe. You brought my Bible. It's okay. I'm okay. Thank you, though. I appreciate you. So, bias, whether we have conscious bias or not. Now, I have a little thing I want to tell you, I want to share with you. In some aspects, I am one of the few people that I know of who have no unconscious bias when it comes to race, ethnicity, or color, or even religion. I'm not saying this as like, oh, Pat Oona, I'm back. No, I'm saying this because I actually took a test. So you guys, you know I'm a crazy person, right? You guys know. So we're talking about, Chris and I were talking about unconscious bias and how do you know if you have unconscious bias? Because I want to address that. I don't want to be unconsciously biased. Right? I want to be fair. I want to be loving to everybody. I don't want to look at somebody and be like, ew, no. I don't want that. I really do want to love people. And so I took this test. And I've got it on my email somewhere because I save every single email. It's a problem. But I have it in my email somewhere. So I'm not saying this as a brag. I took this test. And I started with race, and it came up with no bias. I wasn't surprised. I wasn't surprised. You see, because for those of you who are visiting for the first time, if you're watching online for the very first time, something you may not know about me is I'm of mixed heritage. I am African American, I am Native American, and I am European American. Okay, I'm a mishmash, big ol' mishmash, makes me perfect. No, I'm sorry. So this was confirming what I already knew. If you've ever met my family, my extended family, it is wonderfully, beautifully, wildly mixed. And so this was confirming what I already knew, and I was very thankful. So next, I'm like, oh, they've got more tests on here. Ooh. Right? I'm going to see if I have a bias towards religion. And I was very surprised that I did not have a bias towards religion. And it's so interesting because, hold that thought. I take the next test because now I'm thinking there's a flaw. Right? And I'm a perfectionist. So if there's a flaw, I want to find it. So the next test was about Native Americans and non-Native Americans here in America. If I have a bias. And sure enough, I came up with a bias. A really big, really major bias for Native Americans. So I'm talking with my sister about this bias that I have. This unconscious bias I have towards Native Americans, in favor of them, in favor of Native Americans. And I'm explaining to my sister about this test, because in this test, there are pictures, and they just kind of pop up, and you're supposed to pick which one you like, right? And it's click, 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 and it's fast, I said, well, I'm really wondering about this test, because every single picture that came up was from the 19th century. And for those of you who don't know me, I'm a real history buff, and I know 19th century history and what happened with the Native American issues across our entire country at that time. And so I'm explaining this test to my sister, and she's listening to me, and she's doing this with her mouth. And I'm telling her, I'm like, oh, if you put a picture of Sitting Bull up there, and then you show a picture of James Polk, I mean, how do you think I'm going to, who do you think I'm going to like? Look up James Polk later, it's okay. And so she's laughing. She's trying really hard not to laugh at me, right? And I'm explaining to her, there's nothing modern. It's just this one particular period. And this one particular period was not very positive for the... biases, I'm going to do the best I can to understand what God is trying to say and to remember the context of what God is saying so I can apply it to my life. Amen? So let's start with the easy one. Children, Ephesians chapter 6, verses 1 through 4. As for children, obey your parents in the Lord because it is right. The commandment, honor your father and mother, is the first one with a promise attached, so that things will go well for you and you will live for a long time in the land. As for parents, don't provoke your children to anger, but raise them with discipline and instruction about the Lord. Amen. Amen. Now, every single person in this room was once a child with parents. Every single one of us did not obey our parents at one point or another, and most especially, we did not obey them perfectly when we were young. That word, obey, ugh. Even Bible scholars agree that obey is a stronger word than submit. Obedience doesn't require explanation prior to compliance. But what Paul is trying to do here is to put obey alongside another word that is just as important, honor, and reminding us why it is both why it is important to both obey and honor our parents. Our parents, they know more than us, right? They have more life experience than us, and because of that, we should be doing as they tell us, because what they are telling us isn't coming from a place of harm, but to protect us, to guide us, to save us. And it is important to note that no one really truly understands how important it is to obey your parents until you no longer have them with you. And that is just part of human nature. obey my mother so much better now that she's in heaven. Yeah, it's true. Between last week and this week, I've got an obedience problem. Remember I said I am not an obedient wife? Remember that? I'm not an obedient daughter. I got a problem. You guys need to pray for me. So, obeying parents' teaching is important. Even when how they are teaching isn't always spectacular. Which is why Paul has that reminder to parents to not exasperate their children. Don't provoke them to anger, but to discipline and instruct. In other words, don't let your instruction come from a bubble of because I said so. It is always the parent's responsibility to inform the why to the child. Paul is clear here, and he is only repeating all of every single passage in the entire Bible that talks about how parents are to instruct their children. Things from Proverbs, train up a child the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it, right? Deuteronomy, the one I've always pulled this up, fix your hearts and minds upon me and teach them, teach my word to your children as you go out and as you come back, right? This is always the parent's job. And this isn't just regarding young children. And by young children, I mean not adult children. This even goes for adult children too, okay? I had an interesting moment with my daughter. She was at Point Loma. She's grown, she's out of the house, she's at Point Loma. And she's calling me and we're talking about some situation. And I don't remember if it was like a roommate, dorm mate, someone down the hall. I don't know. There was something going on, right? And so, of course, I'm her mom. I'm going to tell her what I think she should do. Because that's what moms do, right? This is what parents do. And I don't remember what it was that she said, but she said something, and I laughed. And I said, is this your polite way of telling me I heard exactly what you said and I'm not going to do as you're telling me? And she said, yes. Yes, it is. Because you see, there was more to the situation than she was telling me about. And she wanted to approach it in a different way that she could see how she was going to do it. And see, this conversation would not have happened if I hadn't put in that time, that instruction, that admonition, that nurturing when she was young throughout her childhood, right? We miss the ultimate goal of parenting if we aren't doing this teaching. Because our goal is to raise up children to be fully functioning adults who love and serve the Lord. We want them to have that relationship with God, right? That means that we have to actually model that loving parent relationship so they can have it, that same loving parent relationship with God, when we aren't there, because God is. You know, this means that this can't happen if you're hard on your kids, no matter what age they are, you just can't be hard on them. And it doesn't mean that you don't correct them. It doesn't mean that you don't guide them, right? But it does mean that constant, continuous, nagging, belittling, badgering, that's being hard on your child. That trope of, don't you know what your insert parent has done for you can be far outweighed by the don't you know what insert parent has done to me. And parents, we cannot forget that. It is our obligation to correct it, because sometimes the best or easiest way a godly person can honor their father or their mother is through distance. And that is really hard. And for some of us, this passage may have been a harder teaching than we thought it would be. Amen? Okay, let's go forward. Let's talk about slaves. Yay! Let's just jump into it. As for slaves, obey your human masters with fear and trembling, with sincere devotion to Christ. Don't work to make yourself look good and try to flatter people, but act like slaves of Christ, carrying out God's will from the heart. Serve your owners enthusiastically, as though you were serving the Lord and not human beings. You know that the Lord will reward every person who does what is right, whether that person is a slave or a free person. As for masters, treat your slaves in the same way. Stop threatening them, because you know that both you and your slaves have a master in heaven. He doesn't distinguish between people on the basis of status. Ephesians 6, 5 through 9. Remember how I said know your bias? Yeah. I'm not saying put aside your bias. I'm saying know your bias and where it comes from. Check yourself before you act, before you respond. And this passage is a really great place to do this. So what is our bias here? Our bias, I think we can all agree, is that slavery is bad. Yes? Yes. Our bias has been informed by actual events where people were subjugated, dehumanized, and great injustices were committed upon them under the institution of slavery. Right? So before we get all up in arms and want to throw down with Paul, let's take a deep breath and go into some historical context. Slavery was a thing. I'm not saying good thing. I'm saying that Paul is trying to speak into what was happening at the world at the time. Okay? The world had slaves. And I know what you're thinking. Really, Pastor Oona? Really? Come on, this is a cop out. Why didn't Paul call for the end of slavery? I don't know. I don't know if this is something that he would regret later on, because we know that he did. He did call for Philemon to accept Onesimus back, not as a slave, but as a brother in Christ, right? Bible scholars think that Paul wasn't as concerned about temporal, earthly, worldly affairs because he believed Christ was coming back soon. But really, no one knows. And now I'm going to say something completely and totally radical. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. We need to look at these verses and say, what is God saying through Paul that I can apply to my life? What can I learn from this passage to be a more Christ-like follower of our Savior? Because this is why we go to the Bible. We go to the Bible so that we can be transformed by the Word of God. So let's dig in. Let's dig in. And to make this easier on everyone, we're going to go backwards. Because sometimes the why is easier than the how. Okay? So the why is verse 9, part C, the very last part. He doesn't distinguish between people on the basis of status. The he here is God. God does not distinguish between people on the basis of status. Pastor Oona, there's no slavery here in America. I have heard people say this. I have. And are we going to ignore human trafficking? Are we going to? I'm not saying that we have that happening right now in our church right here. No, that's not what I'm saying. But I do think that we do need to stop being naive, and we need to understand that there are layers in this world and, yes, in our country that we do not see. And while I don't necessarily want to go into all of that, because that is a whole other topic, I want us to instead go by understanding the complexities of our society and the way we look at and value or devalue people within this framework called status. Because only then can we fix the problem, or at least one problem, right? We need to understand that there are definite views between those who have and those who don't. Money, no money. Education, no education. Papers, no papers. Power, no power. And Paul is saying it is all irrelevant. God doesn't distinguish between people on the basis of status. Paul may say that, but we see expressions of our views on status all the time. There's a lot on social media out there, and one of those things going about constantly are the videos of how poorly people will treat others, specifically those who serve them. Common human decency isn't the norm. Why are we surprised? Apparently, this has been a problem even in Paul's time. He does say, stop threatening them, meaning masters, right? He says, stop. He's telling masters, owners, stop threatening them, meaning slaves, right? Because you know that both of you have a master in heaven. You cannot tell me, you cannot tell me that if Paul were alive today, that he wouldn't be scrolling through TikToks of people exercising their rights, and he would be like, see, this is exactly what I'm talking about here. Right? God doesn't distinguish between people on the basis of status. How are we treating the people who are considered to be the lowest in society? How are you treating a person whom you look at as being lower or less than yourself? And this is the part that needs to be taken to our hearts in this passage. We need to hear, as for masters, treat your slaves in the same way as what? As yourself. As a person who will be equally rewarded or not by God. And Paul is desperate to remind us to live, to serve, and to exist as people who are serving God. With enthusiasm. To act as though we're carrying out God's will. I could even say love. I could even say love. Let's pretend we love each other, right? Through what we do. Not because we're trying to. If you want to scroll back one or two slides, please. One more. One more. Six. Because we don't want to make ourselves look good or try to flatter people. That's not why we're supposed to be doing this. This is not why we're supposed to be loving and serving God enthusiastically. To make ourselves look good. To flatter others. But we are to act like slaves of Christ, carrying out God's will from the heart. That fear and trembling part in verse 5, that is tricky because it doesn't translate well in our culture. We forget fearing and trembling is how we're supposed to feel about Jesus doing what he did for us, for our salvation. We're not supposed to be trembling in fear, but we should be acknowledging what we deserve and being thankful for what he has given us. Paul is trying so hard to get us to understand the reality of the fact is that we are supposed to be submitting to each other. And now we want to walk it all the way back to Ephesians chapter 5, the entire beginning of this whole passage on submitting. In verse 15, he says, "So be careful to live your life wisely, not foolishly. Take advantage of every opportunity because these are evil times. Because of this, don't be ignorant, but understand the Lord's will. Don't get drunk on wine, which produces depravity. Instead, be filled with the Spirit in the following ways. Speak to each other with psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. Sing and make music to the Lord in your hearts. Always give thanks to God the Father for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And submit to each other out of respect for Christ." My friends, the ultimate submission is to Christ. We are to remember the language Paul is using here in this context is we are supposed to be slaves to Christ. In Paul's context, Jesus bought us through his act of redemption on the cross. Jesus didn't yell or threaten us to follow him. He has me for that. No, I'm kidding. nobody should be threatening anyone. But that's the point here, that no matter what these relationships look like, we can do better. Submitting to each other, loving each other, respecting each other. Today has been a tough day to tackle. Amen. But we did it. Amen. 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 I don't know where you are in your walk with the Lord. But there is something I want us all to remember. Even the hardest, most difficult parts of the Bible can bring us before the throne of God. And if that's you today and you are thinking, "This is crazy, but I actually want to follow this example of Jesus. This example of sacrificial love for all humanity." And you are overcome with how that means you are part of that humanity. I want to pray for you. I want to pray for you. So let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, precious Jesus, Holy Spirit. Lord God, I am trusting that in your infinite wisdom, you are using this difficult passage to bring someone home. And for that person, it's very easy to step into a relationship with Jesus Christ. Short, that you have failed in one way or another, whether intentionally or not. You admit it. It's that horrible, awful word that you hear Christians use, sin. You admit it. God already knows it, and he still loves. My sins. I believe that. I believe that he rose up from the dead because he loved us. That includes me. And right now, all you got to do is see, claim that eternal salvation. For those of you who have heard this message today, it was a hard one. It was a hard one. I do want to pray for you because it was a hard message. This whole section on parents and children, it can be really difficult sometimes. because one of the hardest, most difficult things that parents can do is admit their failures. In our parenting. And every single one of us who has kids, we all feel it. The whole purpose is to do better each and every day. And I know also, too, that it can be especially painful when you have acknowledged a time or times where you have failed your child and they have made a choice not to forgive you. And there can be no pain like that. So I want to pray for you today. I also want to pray, fervently for all of us to examine our bias. I want to pray for each and every single person who walks out that door to remove status from their mind and from their heart and from their soul. And as you walk out those doors and as you walk into the world, remember that every single person on this planet is worth the shed blood of Jesus Christ. And to make a concerted, passionate effort to treat them as though they are. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, precious Savior and Holy Spirit, you want to change us, you want to transform us, you want to work in us, you want to work among us, and you want to work through us. And we are laying it all out right now. We are submitting ourselves to you completely and wholly. We cannot love others without the power of the Holy Spirit in us. We cannot remove or eradicate status without looking at people through the eyes of Christ. We cannot treat people as though they are worth what you say they are if we cannot look at the body of Christ and what he gave up for us. So right now, in this space, we are surrendering it all to you. All of these struggles, all of these points where we think I'm right and they're wrong, remove it. Remove our biases. And instead, Lord God, give us your heart. I think of Ezekiel, how you removed that heart of stone and you put in that heart of flesh. Do that right now. And while all eyes are closed, if you want to accept this challenge this week, please go ahead. You can just raise your hand or look up. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Lord God, you have people here who have your heart, who want your heart, who are chasing after you with every fiber of their being. Lord God, give them your power. Let your Holy Spirit fill them up this week. May they have a good testimony next week of how they saw you doing it and not them. And Lord Jesus, I just want to pray right now for any person here who might have an estranged relationship with their child. We pray right now that the ministry of reconciliation can take place. We pray right now, Lord, that you soften hearts and that you make a way. Because, Lord God, you say, there is a way. In the name of Jesus Christ, our precious, precious Savior, we pray these things. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
opportunities to go and love one another.
chapter 7, verse 9 says, I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and holding palm branches in their hands. And they all cried out with a loud voice, salvation belongs to God, who sits on the throne and the Lamb. And what grabs that with me with the message is that all people, nations, tribes, cultures, are important to God. And so as we see, I think our prayer should be that we should see and love people the way God does. And that I think we probably all need a little help with that. So let us pray. The great and compassionate God that you are, full of love, you created us all uniquely. You created us with your love. You created us with purpose. And you see value in us. Father, we thank you for your love. And Father, we ask, Lord Jesus, that we would be more and more of example of your love to all around us. Father, you created us, and we are all special in your eyes. But we are all equal of humanity. Father, we thank you for that. Father, we ask that you would just help us to take your words, take this message to heart, and help us to turn it into action. We love you, Lord, and we want to be more and more like you, Father, and so help us in the areas that we struggle, Father, and help us to release those things to you so that we can be Jesus to the world around us, to the people around us. We love you, Jesus. Amen. Just a quick announcement, just reminding our weekly Bible studies that we have. Just get involved with that. There'll be it's always a great time to dig into God's Word with other people. Wanted to mention that the women's retreat, the zone retreat, the district is going to be coming up here on September 8th through the 10th. And they need to have a number, an account of people who are ladies who are going to be going. When is the deadline for that?
It's not until the first, but I think you can start to know now who's going.
So as soon as possible. As soon as possible, let us know if you're going, or if you want to go and don't know how you get to go, we will help you with that. And so. Let us know that as soon as possible so we can plan, they can plan for that. Also, I had mentioned to you last week, but now we have it in in the bulletin, an announcement for our Labor Day barbecue. As you are all invited to be a part of that and bring someone with you, bring a side dish or a salad dish if you want. We're going to take care of the burnt offering, so, we're going to take care of the barbecue side, and we will take care of all that stuff. So, we just want to create a great time of fellowship together and just coming together. It's been a while since we've done something like this, so we're looking forward to this time, so... Make sure you mark your calendars. So that is September 3rd, following the service, right after. And so we will be here for a little bit longer than normal. So having a good time together. So, also just being faithful to your tithes and offerings to give to the Lord in a couple different ways. We have the boxes in the back of the sanctuary. You can give, and you can also give online as well. And I have a quick update I wanted to share with you from Ukraine. As most of you know, a good friend of mine, Sergey Ziba, is one of the pastors at the Kiev First Church of Nazarene. Been there for many years. We've been friends for over 20 years. So anyway, he is family to me. He's like my brother, and his family and my family are connected. So his family has chose to stay there during this time of war and to continue to serve the people in their neighborhood and in their church when a lot of people had left for, you know, for their good reasons and whatever those reasons are. The Lord continues to bless them and use them in many different ways. Groups of people have gone out to many parts of the country on the front lines serving those people that have been hard hit. And that's probably not a good word to say, hard hit, but because they have been, missiles have been landing very close to them in many different areas, at home and on around the country as well. Before the church there had closed down for a time because of the starting of the war, and later in this last year that the Lord had been speaking to my friend Sergey and his family, which is all of his children are like in musicians and in a part of ministry, and they do everything together. Felt like it was time for them to start the church back up. And so as before the war, they were a church of maybe 30 to 40 people. After they started up, they were up to about 100 of a new people, starting off, launched off. Awesome. And then as they went on, they went up to 200 people, wow, kept coming. Now there's 500 people coming, wow, to their church right now. And they finally went to two services, and wow, people are talking about another service, which they don't have enough workers to do so. You know, pray for the harvest, you know, and the workers, but God is doing some amazing things, some miracles there. They've had some baptisms already. They're planning on more baptisms coming up, just God is really using them, even in a lot of challenges that they are facing right now, and so continue to pray for them. Pray for also for the Odessa Church of the Nazarene, as their building has been damaged by missiles and drones, but they continue to also serve their community. Since the start of the war, the Odessa Church has baptized over 60 people within the community there, and they continue to feed people and minister to people, one of the other churches of Nazarenes in the area that has been completely demolished, and as well as most of the city, they are partnering with them to help them get into a new place to meet and continue to plan on children's camps throughout this time. They don't stop, you know, because of a war. They continue to serve and as God has led them. So just wanted you to know that. Continue to pray for them. I know there's other things in the world, praying for Hawaii right now, and they truly need it. Please continue to pray for them. We're going to do a last song, and then I have something else to share with you.
I think we're going to pray for a brother after. This is our custom. Can we stand together? And we're going to sing one last chorus together.
Praise God, from whom all blessings. till all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Malachi, can you